hottest music videos on the shot. GhanaMusic.com. It's sizzling hot on GhanaMusic.com.
Just log on.
Okay, so I'm Mano Ganta from GhanaMusic.com.
You're nice to meet you, Mano.
Very much welcome. We just want to know a few details about the brand Fuse ODG.
Yeah.
And we just had you drop from London. You launched your new African Nation album.
Yeah.
And it was a huge success. Could you brief us a bit about maybe the highlight of the program and few things that occurred there?
Yeah, just dropped my new album, New African Nation. We did a launch in London, which was amazing. A lot of people came through, a lot of influential artists came through to support. And what's good about London is different types of people from different genres, you know, not just Afrobeats. They all came down from, you know, gigs to Little Bizzle to Chip to Jamelia, who's like a legend back in the day, we used to watch her growing up, to Akala, who's a serious activist and a rapper, to comedians like Don't Jealous Me. You know, so many people came through. Tim Westwood, a lot of DJs came down as well. Kodja Funt, you know. But yeah, it was an amazing launch. But to me, it's even more important that I do a launch in Ghana, because it's home, you know.
Okay.
Yeah, they're both here, so right now we're there, we're ready to launch the album here. My second album is very important, because even the cover is a reenactment of Kwame Nkrumah when he was giving a speech.
Uh-huh.
You know, we've done the same kind of pose for the cover, so we want to really channel what our forefathers have done, and then kind of carry on their legacy. So I'm looking forward to it. The program is going to be amazing.
Let's hold on to the details right now. Let's keep the listeners hungry for more. Why New African Nation? Why that title? What, New Africa Nation?
Yeah, my first album was This Is New Africa.
Okay.
And This Is New Africa was to change the perception of Africa, to change how people see Ghana, how people see Africa, and to develop love for Africa and for our people to also love themselves.
Okay.
And that was years ago. And fast forward to now, we now have many people who are proud Africans due to all the work that we've been doing with Afrobeats and everything else around Africa. So with this new energy of self-love and self-pride and feeling proud of who they are and where they're from, we have to use it to now build something tangible.
Okay.
You know, we've now become a nation. You know, you can now, you know, see that we've all become a nation. Every Afrobeats is killing it everywhere. You know, so many different Afrobeats artists killing it. It's now a nation. So this album is called New African Nation, because we have now become a nation, and we need to use this nation to now build the Africa that we want to see. So this album really goes into us building together and fighting together.
Okay, there are a whole lot of artists like Fuse ODG who come out with a brand very different, an ideology very different. Why choose a representation of Africa? Why choose Africa? Why sort of be an ambassador for Africa in music?
I didn't choose Africa. Africa chose me.
Okay.
I'm from Africa. This is where I'm from. So I'm just being myself.
Well, Stormzy is from Africa, but you don't see him
Then he's not being himself. But he does acknowledge that he's Ghanaian.
Yeah.
He does acknowledge that he's African. So definitely, I do think he can do a lot more in representing where he's from, because you know you have to really represent who you are, who you truly are. So I think maybe he feels like he's more British than Ghanaian, and I don't blame him as well. But your roots is Africa, and it doesn't matter where or who you are or where you are, Africa is in you. You know, you're not African because you're born in Africa, it's because Africa is born in you, as you know, Kwame Nkrumah would say. So definitely it's very important that every black person represents Africa, no matter what they do. You know, so to me, I'm already in touch with that.
Okay.
And I see them, you know, now, you know, coming along and representing Africa a lot more than they used to.
Okay.
You know, so somebody has to do it, and to me, I'm more than happy to represent Africa to the fullest, you know, 100%, 1,000% in everything that I do, because that's who I am, you know, and I'm very proud of it. And you know, I can be successful in that too, you know.
So is that why you turned down the Band-Aid 30 project?
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the main reasons why I turned it down, because of the way they portray Africa in their visuals, and the lyrics didn't really reflect the Africa that I knew, the Africa that I grew up in, you know, because they were saying there's gonna be, in the lyrics, it's like this only present they get this Christmas is death, mm-hmm. you know, which is not true, because, mm-hmm. you know, I always come to Ghana for Christmas, and I know I'm coming to Ghana for, you know, for love and peace and joy, but in his lyrics, he says there's no peace and joy this Christmas in Africa. So to me, it really just conflicted what I knew,
but
Africa, so I couldn't be a part of that kind of negative portrayal of Africa. Even though it was to raise money in the short term, I felt like it would cripple Africa in the long run, because nobody would want to come to a place where they're coming to die. You come to Africa to live, to invest, to be happy. It's good for your soul. There's opportunities here, you know. So to me, if we promote Africa in that way, because we could have still made a positive song to raise money, and people could still come and invest in Africa.
But at that time, the reason you gave was contrary to what you're just saying. You said that it was slightly different from the original song. It was kind of belittling the importance of the original song. So
that's what I said.
That's what was reported. The independent paper reported that story.
I don't know who the
independent is. You never said that.
I don't know who the independent is.
Alright.
And I never said that.
Alright. Alright, let's move on.
I wrote an article in The Garden. I wrote that one.
Okay.
So if you can search that article,
okay.
Why I turned down Band Aid. You see, in The Garden, it was one of the most read articles that year.
Okay. Alright, so Antenna was a breakthrough song.
Yeah.
We all know how Antenna became a very huge hit. What inspired that song? What inspired that sound? Because
yeah,
it was a rare sound
at the time. We really wanted to do something different, myself and Q-Beat. You know, I like to always try to push the sound, and Q-Beat likes to do the same thing, and we were just having conversation about how can we do something different that nobody else is doing. And of course, like, because I grew up in the UK, I was already exposed to that kind of sound, you know, the dance kind of sound. And it was really, that dance kind of sound was really taking over Europe and everything. So I said to Q-Beat, like, well, we need to just mix the two, you know, the Afro beats and the dance vibe. And the guy I was working with at the time as well in London, Arjun, an Asian guy from Sri Lanka, based in London. You know, again, he's already exposed to that world as well. So me and him, we started an idea, and the idea was pretty much, you know, it had the more dance vibe. So we had all of that down, just so that we locked down the dance part of the song, you know, in the Western world, kind of the Western sound. And then when I linked up with Q-Beat, like, he fell in love with it, because it's already a conversation that we were having. And then he just killed it, you know, switched it and brought it to Africa as well. So it's got a nice balance of the Euro sound and then the African sound as well, with the drums and the groove, you know. So he really killed it with that vibe. So yeah, that's how Antenna came about. It came from just having conversations and wanting to push the sound. And we did that.
Cool. Would you call yourself one of the major influences of the Azonto genre?
Yeah, I think I'm the main guy who actually created awareness of the Azonto dance outside of Ghana.
Good.
Because, you know, a lot of people, first time hearing Afrobeats was through Azonto in the UK and in Europe. And in places like Australia and New Zealand, you know, their first time hearing Afrobeats was me. So definitely we create awareness, not just of Azonto, but of Afrobeats as well.
Why couldn't such a good vibe be sustained
in
for
Ghana?
Long in Ghana, in the world?
I think Ghana should have, you know, embraced them more, and because it's part of our culture. Dance is part of our culture, and Azonto was something that to me could have been like a resource, you know, something that could really attract people to come, because, you know, people were doing workshops with it, you know,
mm-hmm.
people were really creating activities around it, you know, mm-hmm. there was club events based on that, it became a genre. I'd go to that Liberia, I'd go to Uganda, and they were making Azonto music together. So, but I guess everything happens for a reason, and you know, sound move on and people go on to do other things, and I guess that's what happened. But the influence is still, you know, there in terms of how it influenced the whole scene and it influenced Nigeria and their sound and everything. So definitely, you know, Azonto is still, to me, one of the dances that was very powerful. I don't think there's been any other dance that's been, to me, bigger than Azonto.
Okay. So there's been controversies on the originators of Afrobeat.
Yeah.
Would you say it began in Ghana or Nigeria? They say Fela Kuti began it. Others also say Fela Kuti came to learn it from our high life here.
Yeah.
What's your take on that?
Yeah, I don't. It doesn't really, you know, there's no point in arguing about who began it, because, you know, African music has always existed.
But the Nigerians are, you know, all over the place.
Has always existed. You know, with or you know, without our legend Fela Kuti, but Fela Kuti was the main guy to fuse his jazz background with highlife, and of course he came to Ghana to learn about highlife. He came to Ghana to, you know, connect with the highlife musicians and learn from them, and then he mixed it with his jazz background and, you know, his jazz influence, and that's how he created Afrobeat, you know, at the time. And the sound has evolved since then, you know, but definitely he was one of the main people to mix the Afro sound with jazz, which is highlife and Afrobeat, highlife and jazz, and of course with the messages in there, the way he was writing the beats, he was definitely a game changer, you know, and one of the main pioneers. Of course, people like Osibisa also need to be, you know, credited for the mixing of the different genres as well. So yeah, definitely Fela Kuti, one of the main people to spearhead Afrobeats and create the sound.
Okay.
But Ghana definitely was a major influence.
Okay, cool. Let's drop down to the Ed Sheeran story. We saw you around. We saw you one day walking on the streets of Accra with Ed Sheeran.
Yeah.
How did that connection happen?
Chocolate coconut. Nah, we would usually bump into each other during festivals, and then I told him to, when he saw me, he's like, I mean, I was a big fan, and when he saw me, he's like, yeah, he loves my music as well. Like, and as soon as he said that, I said, well, then come Ghana. Like, if you love Afrobeats, then come Ghana and just soak in some pure Afrobeats. He said, sweet, I'd love to. So pretty much we stayed in touch, and eventually he messaged me saying that, yeah, he wants to come, he offers to love. I said, yeah, 100%. You know, yeah, sure.
Just like that.
Yeah, just like that. And literally, I think he was in Australia at the time, booked his flight. I met him in Ghana. We stayed for like a week making great music. And what's good about him is he's such a free spirit that he likes to embrace different cultures, and he really got involved and even came to the school that we're working on, donated funds for us to buy a bus and help to fix a bridge. And to this day, he's still helping with the school project. And, you know, he really came and he enjoyed our music. You know, he loved people like Joey B, you know, when he came, a lot of people like Sucker MVs, you know, so I like how he came and he really just fell in love with our culture to the point where he got a tattoo on his ribcage, you know, after his trip to Ghana. And he said it was one of the most painful tattoos that he's ever had in his life, but it was worth it, you know. So definitely he's someone that I really, you know, admire and respect, and I'm glad that he came and we made some great music for my album and for his album as well, and to win a Grammy with it.
Okay, so it's very clear that he came to absorb some African vibes,
yeah,
and it influenced his music.
100%.
On the other side, did his coming here have an influence on your music?
100%. His coming here definitely influenced me as an artist, as a songwriter. You know, I love the way that he, you know, he makes music. I love the way that he writes music. And I was very much inspired by it, and 100%, you know, when you hear my album, you can see that, you know, I've been around some amazing songwriters, and he's one of them that definitely influenced me. You can tell when you listen to the album, so yeah, make sure you check out the album, African Nation, catch the vibes.
Alright, so it's it's a new African Nation album, and everyone is all over it. Could you give us some highlights, just an exclusive to what we should expect at the Plus 233 Bar and Grill?
18th of April, Plus 233, expect vibes, expect energy, of course, a live band. I've never done an intimate show like this in Ghana before. It's my first, so it's definitely a historical night. You don't want to miss out on you know, Fuse ODG's first intimate historical night, because you know we're here forever representing Ghana, and we're going to take this to a whole new level. So come and experience this journey from early Plus 233. You're going to hear some exclusive music, you're going to hear some classics. Of course, I have some special guests who are going to be around, so you can get to mingle with them and catch vibes with them and take pictures and have a great time. And come with your dancing shoes and your thinking hats, because we're going to move and move with the movement. Right.
Cool.
Come on.
Cool. A few questions to go in with then.
Yeah, let's go.
Nana Dolls.
Yeah.
What inspired that idea? It blew everyone's mind away. Yeah, what inspired that idea?
Because people didn't expect, you know, an artist to come up with an idea like that. But it came from, you know, being in burning to toy stores and, you know, looking for a present for your niece and not being able to find something that looks like them. You know, it's very disappointing that we're going to these toy stores and 99% is white dolls, and we're in Ghana.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't make any sense. So they need to reflect the consumers. These kids need to know that they can have dolls that look like them. You mm-hmm. know, that they matter. They have royalty inside of them. And what's more amazing was we went to a Mino concert and, you know, hearing the story of Yasan to our room, we realized that we can actually do dolls, black dolls, and have it based on these historical leaders. So when these kids are playing with it, they're also learning about their history.
Good.
They're also learning about where they're from. You know, so this I'm looking at one of the boxes, and one of them is Nanaya, based on Yasantura, and it says that this queen is brave, she's confident, fearless, she loves to inspire and guide others. So all of these is like education for these kids, for them to learn about these attributes that they have inside of them. They just need to find it. They need to know that it's possible for you to become a leader like Yasin Tua. And one of them is also based on Nana Kuti, Fela Kuti's mom. Another is based on Fela Kuti's mom being Fumilayo Kuti, the first woman to drive in Nigeria. Another one is based on Miriam Makeba from South Africa. Nana Makeba, of course, who helped eradicate apartheid. And you know, it's nice for these women to, these young girls to understand that they have these leaderships in them. And each one comes with a storybook as well. So this is the Nanaya, we have a Nanaya and the Golden Story.
Okay.
And again, it talks about for our history, you know, the Golden Story being taken by the British and this woman standing up and saying, if you men are not gonna stand up and fight, us women, we will. You know, so these girls need to understand that you have this power inside of you, you're a queen. You know, so these books are now available, you know, in all major bookstores online in the UK. We're going to launch it in Ghana as well. So yeah, man, it's a mission that we're excited about, because it's about changing lives and instilling self-love in these young kids.
It might seem like a toy, but the idea behind it, it's so great, so deep.
Thank you.
It attacks the racist issue.
Yeah.
It attacks the inferiority complex issue of Africans and all that. Yeah. So I'll say a big thank you on that note.
Thank you.
Let's push past this. Do you have any political aspirations? Because the way you carry yourself about, it seems so.
Yeah, I don't really sit down and think that I want to get into politics. No, I'm just a person who wants to help others. I'm an artist. We don't really get on with like politics or politicians, because, you know, we feel like there's a lot of crookedness in that world. As an artist, we usually rebel against the systems, you know, because we always feel like the systems could do a lot better. So I don't know, I'm just, you know, an artist, you know, right now, who wants to make music and use it to help others.
But what the brand of Fuse ODG, what it stands for, is presenting a whole new picture of Africa, and to do that you'll need much power.
Yes, 100%. And we are working with, you know, the government in Ghana. Actually, he made me the tourism ambassador and also the corporate ambassador.
That's political.
It is political, but I'm just carrying on doing what I'm already doing, which is promoting Ghana to the world.
Okay.
You know, and it's not like it gives me anything for it like that. You know, it just makes everything look official. So like, if I'm talking to an artist, or if I'm talking to another company outside of Ghana and wanting them to come to Ghana, I can get a letter from the president. You know, they just make things official. And yeah, I appreciate the support. Of course, they could do a lot more. Like I said, we always feel like the system could do a lot better. You know, so hopefully we'll be able to work a lot more and help to push Ghana to the top. You know, because that's my mission.
Okay.
You know, to instill self-love in our people and for us to be self-sustainable as a country.
Okay. As an international act, do you think Ghanaian music has made its mark on the global music scene? If yes, why? If no, why?
So Ghana has a population of 29 million people.
Mm-hmm.
Nigeria has a population of 199 million people.
Mm-hmm.
And Ghana gets mentioned just as much as Nigeria gets mentioned.
Mm-hmm.
You know, our music has influenced the whole of Africa.
Mm-hmm.
Fully influenced the whole of Africa. Our music is heard in almost every country in Europe. Our music is heard in the US. If you go to Europe, you see that the people reigning are usually from Ghanaian backgrounds.
Mm-hmm.
UK is usually Ghanaians running it. Like, we have definitely made a major impact on the world, considering that we're not such a high populated country. And that's how powerful Ghana has always been. The fact that we were the first country to gain independence in sub-Saharan Africa means that it's a special land.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this, the fact that Fela Kuti came here to get inspiration means we're a special land. The fact that Martin Luther King came to Ghana, a lot of people don't know this, he came to Ghana when Kwame Nkrumah was giving his speech for independence. The fact that all these people came to Ghana to get inspiration, like someone like Luther King came to get inspiration to help with the civil rights movement in America, goes to show how special the land is. You know, so definitely Ghana has influenced the world in terms of music. You know, a lot of people that are, you know, at the top of the music game, heavily influenced by Ghana. Major Lazer, Ed Sheeran, you know, Beyonce, you know, who Major Lazer made music for, you know, all influenced by our music and our vibes. You know, so definitely we shouldn't take it lightly. We have the potential to also reach the world with our own local music in terms of the local artists. You know, I'm a perfect example that is possible.
Okay.
You know, so definitely Ghana influences the world with the music.
Okay. So your brand, your record label, do you have any idea of signing any other young talent from Ghana?
Yeah, 100%. We're on the lookout for new talent. Because yeah, we have the resources, we're ready to support local talent. So definitely Off The Ground Records, we're open and ready. You know, so any talent, you know, tag me, at me, whatever. I'm ready and I'm open, man. You know,
Could you give us
working with local people, man. My album was produced by mostly Ghanaian producers.
Mm.
You know.
Okay, could you give us an exclusive to a couple of people you're looking at as of now? Just not signing on officially, just looking at.
I mean, I'm looking at Felimina.
Okay.
That's about it right now.
Okay.
So if you have any recommendations, you let me know.
Alright. Mm-hmm. Alright, cool. Are you into any CSR? You just mentioned that you're doing a school project and all that. Could you...
But everything that I do is CSR.
Okay.
So I'm always, okay. You know...
Well, what majority of people see as CSR? You know?
Yeah, I mean, yeah. Okay, cool. So we've got the school in Akosombo.
Okay.
It started as an orphanage, then it turned into a primary school because the local people wanted to come to it. It's open, it's free, wherever you can afford. If you can't afford it, you can still come. Most of the kids also stay behind and sleep over, you know. But yeah, we've been working on it for years, way before the music even blew up. 2007, the kids even grow. Some of them became teachers and have become teachers at the school.
Okay.
So we're now working on the secondary school because when they leave the primary school, some of them can't afford to really travel to get to the nearest, you know, affordable secondary school. So we're working on that one right now. We're raising funds for it. So if you want to donate, you know, gofundme.com/weWillRiseTogether with a Z. But yeah, the building is going on. If you want to donate a brick, you can, you know, have your name on the wall as well. So it's something that I'm really excited to see come up. But it's one of it's at the center of everything that we do. And that's why everybody that comes to Ghana, I take them to the school. You know, so definitely I'm excited about that project.
Okay. So what's the name of the school?
New African Nation X Woodward Missions.
Okay. Okay. Okay, that's cool. Could you give us, we need just one exclusive of what we'll be seeing on the night.
One exclusive? You just have to
of
come.
The album launch.
The whole thing is exclusive. You have to really come.
Just one.
Well, first of all, it's the first time the Fuse ODG has done an intimate show. Okay. Where you guys are very close to me.
How intimate will it be?
We're catching a vibe. It's the venue is first come, first served. You know, it's going to be very tight. And the hospitality is going to be on point. And yeah, exclusive music. You know, it's never happened before like that. Fuse ODG in Ghana. So I'm glad that I'm doing it here, you know.
All right.
Yeah.
All right. So I think what we need to know, you've heard. We're very grateful for passing through GhanaMusic.com studios. We'll definitely do this one more time.
I'm ready.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
It's been an honor.
Nice one.
The hottest music videos on the chart. GhanaMusic.com. It's sizzling hot on GhanaMusic.com.
Just log on.